Hey, Anchor Church, I'm so glad that you're here with us to hear from God's Word and to worship the one true God. Today, we're starting our brand new sermon series called Devoted, and we're going to be looking at the book of Acts. And it's really important that we look at this because on Easter, we got to celebrate the launching of Anchor East. And I'm so excited for that launching. I'm so excited for what God's doing up in Chama, as well as at Anchor North. And God really is moving on all three of these fronts. And we saw it fitting that after celebrating Easter and the hope that we have in Jesus, to now look at the early church and how God moved through the early church, how the disciples devoted themselves to what God had called them to. And to be honest with you, I really like the book of Acts because it's interesting that it is the sequel, if you will, to the Gospel of Luke. It's written by the same author, and it's intended to be read after the Gospel of Luke. Luke himself is very detail-oriented, and what's really interesting is when he writes these books, he addresses them to Theophilus. Now, whether or not that's actually the name of the guy who sponsored him to do this, that's beside the point. But what's really cool is in both Luke and in Acts, Luke is telling the audience of this, of the book, that he went and he investigated what happened. He went and interviewed people. He did the hard work for us so that, in his words, he could weave together a concise account of what happened. Luke obviously follows the events before Jesus' life, as well as what happened in Jesus' life. And then Acts picks up after the crucifixion and just before Jesus ascends to heaven. And in both cases, like I said, he's very detail-oriented, telling us he went and interviewed people to see what had happened. So let's go ahead and dive in and look at what Luke has written for us in the book of Acts, starting in chapter 1, verses 1 through 2. Luke writes, "I wrote the first narrative, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up, after he had given instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen." Now, when beginning Acts, Luke kind of circles back and recaps a little bit about what Jesus did just before his ascension. And in verse 3, he tells us exactly that. It says, "After he had suffered," he being Jesus, "he also presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God." Now, I mentioned this last week at my church, and I think it's really important to note here that, yes, this is a massive claim that Jesus died on the cross and then was resurrected 3 days later. That is a big claim. However, we can trust what God's word says. When Jesus came back to the disciples after being resurrected, he reveals himself to his disciples. And now this is not like a picture of Bigfoot where it's like a blurred picture of Jesus walking in the background. Like, Jesus came to his disciples and they knew who he was. He told them who he was, and they recognized him. They knew who Jesus was, and he's teaching them about the kingdom of God, which also is an important note here, because these people that Jesus is visiting with, he had already been teaching about God. So they would recognize, yeah, this is the way that Jesus used to teach, or yeah, Jesus said the same things. It's important to note that, because if it was a different person teaching about God in a different way, they would have been able to know that, because this is like recent memory when Jesus was teaching about God before the crucifix. And so I think it's really important to note that here when we look at the Bible, because sometimes it receives undue skepticism, but realistically, the Bible is like the gold standard for historical data. But let's move on. Acts chapter 1, verses 4 through 5. "While he was with them, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for the Father's promise, which, he said, you've heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit in a few days. So let's look at this from Jesus' perspective here, or excuse me, the disciples' perspective here. Jesus was healing people. He's forgiving sins in the Gospels, and he's doing incredible miracles. He's doing amazing things. And then he's betrayed by one of his disciples and brought before the government, the Sanhedrin, the Jewish Supreme Court, if you will. And the Sanhedrin, they put Jesus through really a joke of a trial. In fact, they break two or three of their own laws just to give Jesus a death sentence and hand him over to the Romans. So he's handed over to the Romans. He's tortured. He's crucified. And 3 days later, he's resurrected and came back to the disciples. And they're in shock and in disbelief, I imagine. And he tells them, stay in Jerusalem and wait for the Father's promise, the Holy Spirit. And I can imagine the disciples are very confused. They're thinking to themselves, hang on a second, you were just resurrected from the dead. Now you're telling us to wait here and wait for the Holy Spirit. But they had this expectation, it was really difficult for them to shake, that Jesus was a political savior, not a spiritual savior, or at least not as much of a spiritual savior. So they had the expectation that Jesus was going to come and he was going to overthrow the Romans and establish Israel as their own nation once again. So they're expecting Jesus to be this king over them that would rule and reestablish their nation. But, as usual, God had bigger plans for mankind. God sees the bigger picture in what we actually need. Listen to Jesus' response, Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 8. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, are you restoring the kingdom to Israel at this time? And Jesus says to them, it is not for you to know times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Jesus knows this political expectation that he has, or that they have, and he corrects them. Not only is he correcting them, but he's speaking of the day of the Lord, when final judgment will come. Again, the disciples not fully comprehending what he's saying, they're like, oh, okay, so you are going to reestablish Israel and overthrow the Romans, but it's not for us to know when. But Jesus tells them, it's not for you to know because God has a timeline to accomplish what he wants done. As much as we may try to rush Jesus or God along, at the end of the day, the timeline is in God's hand, and he does what he wants when he wants. And he tells the disciples something that I'm sure was very confusing in light of their political hopes. And he tells them they're going to receive power from the Holy Spirit, and they are going to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth. Man, I imagine with, again, their political ideas here, they're like, wait, so we're not supposed to know when you reestablish Israel, but now we're supposed to go tell people that you're going to go establish it. Like, I'm sure there was much confusion here. Now, thankfully, hindsight is 2020, right? And we can look back and we can see what Jesus is talking about here. He's talking about the Great Commission. And this is a monumental task that Jesus has given the disciples and has been handed down through all believers to now to us here at Anchor Church and all the believers who are alive now on earth. This is a massive task being Jesus's witnesses to the ends of the earth. In fact, 2,000 years later, we're still working on this task, and God is good and he's sovereign over this. He's working in our midst and leading us here. But I want to emphasize the fact that the disciples are just ordinary people. Sometimes we can get this idea in our head of the disciples as being like these super spiritual or, you know, celebrity type people, but they're just fishermen. That's what God's word says. You know, they are tax collectors, fishermen. They're just regular people. In fact, most of them really weren't even that educated. And yet Jesus gave them this task at hand. I think sometimes we can get it backwards here, and we can sometimes maybe assume that the Great Commission, sharing the gospel with people, is just for celebrity pastors or for leaders in the church. But that's really not the case. If you are a believer in Christ Jesus, then it is your job to go and share the gospel with people who don't know the gospel. It is your job to share Jesus with anyone and everyone around you. Just like Jesus choosing the disciples to do this work, now we are now chosen to do this work as well, since we are in Christ Jesus. And honestly, this task is why I started Anchor East. It's why Jared started Anchor North. It's why God is stirring up a work in Chama. It's to share the gospel to the ends of the earth, to share the gospel with a world that is so broken and in desperate need for good news. That's why this church is here. That's why all of the churches on earth that God has started, that's why they're there. It's to go and share the gospel. But similarly, as Jesus pointed out, I would like to highlight here as well that he told them they needed to wait for the Holy Spirit to come to them. You know, a few weeks ago, we preached on Ezra and Nehemiah, and this falls right in line with that, that we need God's empowerment to do God's work. We need to make sure that we're filled with the Holy Spirit in order to make sure our goals are lined up with what God wants. Not only that, we need to make sure that we're filled with the Holy Spirit so that we can be empowered to go and do it. Now, those two things are very important, and sometimes it can kind of come across as like this super magical spiritual thing that you need to make sure you're filled with the Holy Spirit. But realistically, all that means is that you're walking closely with God. You're praying, you're seeking after God and His Word, and you're walking closely with Him so that you, one, can know what He wants, and two, you can be empowered to go and do it, that God would send you out and you would go and do it. Anything apart from that, and as we learn with Ezra and Nehemiah, unintended consequences can happen and you end up not reaching your goal. After Jesus told the disciples they would receive the Holy Spirit, Jesus told them to wait, and then he ascends to heaven. Now, this scene always cracks me up, and to be honest, I'm probably injecting more humor in this situation in my brain than there really was in real life. But here the disciples are staring up at heaven and watching as Jesus is just ascending to heaven, which I would stare at that too. That would be quite the sight to see. But listen to this, Acts chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. After he had said this, he was taken up as they were watching, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, they were gazing into heaven, and suddenly two men in white clothes stood by them. And they said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up into heaven? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven, he will come in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven." I just imagine them staring into the sky, just watching with mouths wide open, watching Jesus ascend, and then being startled by the angels, and the angels being like, "Guys, come on, he gave you a job to do, go and do it." I have a bad habit of turning to humor by default, but what do the disciples do next? Well, they gather everyone together. Listen to this, Acts chapter 1, 12 through 13. "Then they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. And when they arrived, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James." Now, this next part is so important. So we've got a list of all the people that are there. They're in a room upstairs in some building. We're not given a good description of where it is. And I think that's on purpose, because if we were, let's be honest, we'd make a shrine out of it. We would worship that rather than God, who did the work that made that room significant. But we're given a list of all the people who are there. And this next part is so key. Acts chapter 1, verse 14. They were all continually united in prayer, along with the women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. The believers came together and they were united in prayer. You could like bold those words, italicize, underline, highlight. They were united in prayer. You know this is a movement of God because people are united. But not only that, it's because it's God who unites people to begin with. God is the great one, or the one who's the great uniter. He unites all of humanity. You know, when you look at a church, there's so many different kinds of people from so many different backgrounds, and yet they're all united by God. I think that's so significant. There's this shirt I have that I like to wear, and it says, "The gospel unites all," and I love it because it's so true. Regardless of who you are, regardless of your background, regardless of anything, God can unite all people under Christ Jesus in the gospel. The blood of the Lamb unites all people. And I love that fact. I love to beat that drum every chance I get. But again, it's God who unites people. He's bringing them together, and they're all united in seeking God's face and looking to see where God is leading. Vance Pittman, who is the director of Sin Network, recently said this of prayer, and I think it's a very good quote here. It says, "The reason we have not seen revival in the American church is because we have relegated prayer to a time where the pastor prays and the band moves off stage." Or other times he said, it's where we pray and the band moves on and off the stage, or we change the backgrounds and the screens so that people don't see it. And it's so true. In the American church, we have forgotten the importance of prayer. What a gut check that we have forgotten the importance of prayer. Or we know that it's important and we've neglected it. Have you ever tried praying, like intentionally sitting down and praying? It is a hard thing to do. So many distractions pop up. I mean, seriously, you could sit down in your living room, maybe have a little worship music on low, and you're trying to sit there and trying to collect your thoughts, and you start beginning praying, and someone could just like jump through your window and be like, "Your car, we've been trying to reach you, but your car's extended warranty." I mean, it's insane. Prayer is so difficult because the enemy hates it. He knows this is the avenue of power that God has chosen to empower God's people. Prayer is so significant. And of course, I'm being sarcastic with someone jumping through your window about your car's extended warranty. But it's true. If you try and sit down and pray, all sorts of distractions come through the woodwork. Your phone blows up. Something happens outside. Your kids start crying for no reason. X, Y, Z, you list it, and distractions will come when you try and pray. But it plays such a big role, and we're so quick to forget it. And it reminds me of a scene from Nacho Libre. Now I know, just the mere mention of that movie, some people are laughing. Some people are rolling their eyes at me even mentioning Nacho Libre. And even still, some more people don't even know what I'm talking about. And all three reactions are totally acceptable. But there's a point in the movie where Jack Black's character is in a predicament, and he runs to the church and he begins praying, asking God for help. And he sits there, and he's sitting there, and he's waiting, and he's looking. And then he jumps up and says, "I don't have time for this," and he runs out of the church. And that totally captures our attitude towards prayer. if we remember it and if we don't neglect it, we try and rush results and we are convinced that God either doesn't know the urgency of our request or just doesn't care. And we abandon it before, honestly, we can make any progress with prayer. Many of us, myself included, are guilty of neglecting prayer. Not just personal prayer, but corporate prayer as well. Listen to this quote from Daniel Henderson, which if any of you are looking for a book on prayer, Daniel Henderson has got some great books and devotionals on prayer. But listen to what he has to say on prayer. People often ask, which is more important, private prayer or corporate prayer? And our answer is a resounding yes. This is like asking which leg we need to walk, the right or the left. Sadly, in Western culture, we have essentially amputated our corporate prayer leg and are often lame on our private prayer leg. A healthy and biblical balance in both prayer, corporately and private, requires diligence. And so we see both private and corporate prayer all through the scriptures. And this is a great example here. Again, they gathered everybody and they were united in prayer, seeking God, seeking his wisdom, and waiting like Jesus had commanded. Listen to how many were gathered. Acts chapter 1, verse 15. In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers and sisters, and the number of the people who were together was about 120. So we're looking at a group of 120 people gathered, and they're praying. They're seeking after God's face. And what's their first order of business? Well, the first order of business that they're attending to is replacing Judas. You see, Judas, as we're told in the book of Acts here, he took the silver that he got for betraying Jesus, he purchased a field, and he hung himself and ended his life. And this is well known. In fact, they even named the field that he had purchased the Field of Blood because they knew who purchased it and why they purchased it, and they knew that he died there. Listen to Peter here, Acts chapter 1, verses 21 through 22. Therefore, from among the men who have accompanied us during the whole time the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day he was taken up from us, from among these, it is necessary that one become a witness with us of his resurrection. They wanted another player on the team, so to speak. There was so much to be done that, as Peter said, it is necessary that one become a witness with us of the resurrection. And what he's saying here is, look, Judas was a part of the team and he had responsibilities before he betrayed Jesus. There were regular responsibilities that they were in charge of in ministry as being witnesses of Jesus. And now that Judas had ended his own life and had abandoned Jesus and the disciples, they needed someone to cover the responsibilities that Judas had left behind. Now, listen to their stance towards God. Acts chapter 1, verses 23 through 24. So they proposed two. Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "You, Lord, know everyone's hearts. Show which of these two you have chosen." Man, how good is that? They know God sees everything. He sees our hearts. He sees our needs. He knows our thoughts. He knows the words we're going to speak. And they're laying it all out on the table, saying to God, it's truly up to you to choose between these two. And so, Acts chapter 1, verse 25 through 26, we see them choosing who that is. To take the place in this apostolic ministry that Judas left to go where he belongs. Then they cast lots for them, and they fell to Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. Now, interestingly, this is the last time in all of Scripture where it's recorded that people cast lots to know what God's will is. Now, we actually don't know how it worked, and we don't know if it was like stones or they're pulling sticks or if they're flipping coins. We don't know how to cast lots. And I think it's important. I think it's intentional that we don't know, because we don't need to do that now. Now we have the Holy Spirit who lives inside of us. We have God's Word. With the Holy Spirit and God's Word, we're able to seek after God's face, and with prayer as well. We're able to seek God's wisdom. We're to seek His guidance. We don't need to cast lots. It's totally unnecessary now because we literally have God living with us. But either way, they cast lots, and Matthias was chosen as the next disciple to take over for Judas. So you listening to this, yes, you looking at your screen, how does this apply to you? How are you supposed to change what you're doing in light of all of this? What are you supposed to do in light of God's word? Well, for starters, Jesus said we need to be His witnesses to the ends of the earth. This is not just a call for celebrities who are believers. This is not just a call for people with big social media platforms. This is not for people with big followings or leaders or pastors. It's for every single believer in Christ Jesus. This is our job, to share the gospel with people. And I promise, it is a lot easier than you think it is. I remember the first time I shared Jesus with someone, with a total stranger I didn't know. I was at UNM, I was on campus, and I had a Bible track. And I remember talking to this guy, and I was so nervous. I was shaking. I remember feeling sweat rolling down my back, and I was terrified. And I'm holding this gospel track. I'm like, so Jesus offers us forgiveness. And I'm like, I was freaking out. And I'm sure this kid was like, I don't know what this guy's problem is, but I'll listen to him speak. So I shared the gospel. And at the end of it, after I had shared the gospel, I had mustered the strength to do this, the guy goes, yeah, I'm not interested, but I got to go to class. So I'll see you later. I was like, oh, and I just about collapsed on the floor right there. But what matters in that story is that I shared the gospel with him. Doesn't matter that I was nervous. Doesn't matter that I was awkwardly sweaty. It doesn't matter that I was shaking. What matters is that I shared the gospel. The rest is up to God. And I'm telling you right now, we as believers were called to do this. But on top of that, God has provided us with so many good and easy to use tools and resources to be able to share the gospel with people. Personally, I really like what's called the 1-Minute Witness, which is put together by the Great Commission Alliance. It's super easy to use. Really, all you do is you give 3 descriptive words of what your life was like before Jesus, how you met Jesus, and then 3 descriptive words that describe your life after Jesus. And then you tell them what your life would be like if you did not meet Jesus. And it's really easy to get down to 60 seconds or less. It's a really easy tool. Look them up, Great Commission Alliance. But there are so many other tools. It's just a quick Google search away. There's so many resources on how to share our faith that make it easy to do. Again, the person's response, that's not your responsibility. Whether or not they become believers or not, that's not your responsibility. Whether or not they choose to cuss you out or whatever, that doesn't matter. What matters is that you share the gospel. After that, ball is outside of your court and you've done your part. What about your prayer life in light of what we read? What is your personal private prayer life? I've heard it said that our prayer life is the easiest way to gauge our spiritual health. How often do you pray? What are you praying for? God tells us that there's nothing too small and insignificant to bring to Him, and there's nothing too big to bring to Him as well. What are you praying to God about? You know, another statement that I heard that was real convicting was, do you spend more time talking to your brothers or talking to your friends about Jesus? Or do you spend more time talking to Jesus about your friends? Both are important, but we definitely should be talking to Jesus about our friends before we tell our friends about Jesus. We should be praying and seeking God, asking for God to soften people's hearts, and then going out and sharing the gospel. You know, prayer is the real work of the ministry. It's hard work, but it's good. It takes practice, but once you get there, once you keep working at it, it gets better and better, and God works through it. Prayer works. Now, talking about prayer and sharing the gospel, these are two really easy areas for believers to maybe not be where they should be, but I want to encourage you, one, there's grace. God is good, and because of what Jesus did, we have grace that covers our shortcomings and covers our mistakes. But we have the Holy Spirit and God's Word to reorient us, to show us what's important and lead us into what we should be doing. So if maybe you're not where you need to be or want to be in these two areas, seek after God, pray to God, and read His Word, asking God to reorient your life. Psalm 19:9, it's not going to be on the screen, but it says, the fear of the Lord is pure and enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are reliable and altogether righteous. David goes on to write a few verses down that God's word brings light to the eyes. Oftentimes back then, they described people who were not perceptive to God as being blind, but those who had sight were perceptive to God. And David tells us that God's word brings sight to our eyes. It brings light to our eyes. It makes us sensitive to the things of God. Turn to the Lord and seek His face. Let's pray. Father God, I thank You so much for Your word. I thank You that You do call us to such an amazing task, God. You have chosen to use people in the greatest rescue operation in all of creation, Lord God. There is no bigger job than sharing the gospel with people around us, God. And You have called us to this. You have given us the privilege to be able to do this with You. Lord God, I pray that You would stir our hearts at Anchor East, Anchor North, and in Chama, Lord God, that we would be pursuing after You, that we would be sharing Your gospel with people around us, Lord God. I pray right now for divine appointments for all three churches, Lord, for the people in these churches, that You would set opportunities in front of them to be able to share the gospel. And I pray that the people that they encounter, that they would have soft hearts, Lord God, and that You would give the words to Your believers to be able to speak to them. Lord God, that we would see salvation and baptisms and lives changed by the power of God at Anchor East, Anchor North, and up in Chama. Lord, all these things I pray in Your name. Amen. Well, church, there's no better time to worship God than after hearing His word. Join us for worship.